are not just satisfied with the birth, crucifixion, and resurrection of God. I want to know him. I want to know where he lives. I want to know how he feels. I want to know what he thinks. I want to be part of his future. I want to be part of his plans. I want to be someone he can trust. I want to be someone he can call. I want to be someone that is in the meeting, not hear about the meeting. I want to be somebody that's a part of what God is doing in the United States and in the world. I want to know him. That every move that I make, see, but I can't get past the birth, crucifixion, and resurrection. I can't get past any of that because every day I get into a place where I need a Savior. Every day I keep making mistakes and I need a Savior. Every day I keep fumbling, falling, and saying and doing and acting the wrong way, and I'm in need of a Savior, and I need to keep resurrecting God every day, every day, every day. And I don't realize that the manna that he has for me is for today, and I can eat that manna. I can eat as much as I can because tomorrow he'll renew that. Because I'm so caught up in the man I had yesterday and the day before. I want to know what he was thinking. Let's go to Matthew chapter 16. Provoking a thought. He's leaving us clues like a mystery, but he wants me to dig. He wants me to get in. You know, there's a verse that keeps just popping out of my mind that says, to your reasonable service. He says, God says, I'm not asking you to do anything for me that's unreasonable. It's your reasonable service. It's easy. It's what you got to do. So your job says, I'm going to pay you the least that I can pay you and try to get the most that I can out of you.
Yeah, you get it right? You have a job like that or no job that... If you have a job that pays you more than they should and you do less than you think you deserve, I want your job. But every job I've usually come encounter with, they want to pay me the least that they can and they want to take the most out of me. Amen? Well, God isn't like that. God says, I just do the minimum, baby. Just do the little bit, baby. If you could just do the minimum, then we can work with that. But we struggle in our reasonable service. We struggle with the easy thing. We struggle with the little thing. We struggle with, the Bible says, it's the little foxes that spoil the vine. Sure, you killed the giant, but your garden is filled with little foxes. Right? Man, I'm a giant killer. But I get tripped up in the little things. And I'm tired of getting tripped up in the little things. I'm ready for the little things to say, get out of the way. Here he comes. Because I know what God is thinking. He's on my mind. I'm not just on his mind. See, Valentine's Day just passed. I had to go above and beyond my reasonable service as a husband. I had to do a little more. Come on now. See, so now is what I'm asking you to do is to think about doing a little more for God. When is your Valentine's Day with God? You know what I'm saying? When is that love? I'm just in love with God. I want to do. And you know what? When Valentine's came, it came time for me to spend that money. It came time for me to give my wife something special as a reflection of my love. It was easy. It was reasonable. It was simple. It was easy to do. Like, I want to do this. I'm excited to do this. I want to do it. I get all giddy. I'm like, I wish I could see your face. And I'm ready to, you know. And you know what? And God is like, well, what about me, man? What you do? What you say to me? What you doing for me? What you thinking about me? Right? Matthew 16:23 says, this is where I think we're at as a body, as a people. This is where I think that we're at. Watch. This is what I think about myself. And this is what I think about you. But he turned to Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me. For you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. Peter knows the flesh of God, but not the mind of God.
Because before that, Peter says, hey, Jesus, if you die, I'll die with you. If you go to prison, I'll go to prison with you. Hey, Jesus, I'm going to hang out with you no matter what happens. And after he says all that and puts his foot in his mouth, Jesus calls Peter Satan. He says, because you know what, Peter? You know my body, but you don't know my mind. You want to lay down your life. You want to speak about things that you can't handle, that you can't do, because it never produced in your mind. It only produced in your emotions.
Peter walked with God. Jesus, God, whatever. Peter walked with Jesus. He loved him. But he fell in love with his flesh. He didn't know his mind. Peter didn't know the mind of God until after the resurrection of the crucifixion. Because when Jesus called him Satan, he goes further on to say, the cock will crow after you have denied me three times. Because Jesus knew the mind of Peter, but Peter never knew the mind of Jesus. Because if he had known the mind of Jesus, he would have done it and not said it. Got to work a little bit. Let me just work on this a little bit. Let me just mold and put things in perspective here. So Peter walks with Jesus and he knows Jesus. And it's like, okay, as long as times are going good, Jesus, I'm going to hang out with you. But you know what? I'll tell you that when things get bad, I'm going to be with you. When things get bad, I'm going to hang out with you. But in reality, the moment that things went sour, Peter went sour with them. Because his mind was never into it. His mind had never conceived it. He had never had the true relationship of the mind of God until after the crucifixion. Well, we're post-crucifixion now. Over 2,000 years ago, we're post-crucifixion. And I'm inviting you today into the mind of God. I'm inviting you into a higher place. I'm inviting you into something different, something beyond emotion, something beyond temptation, something beyond the struggle. But really knowing the mind of God.
I'm almost done. Actually, I only have one more verse. I'm almost done. Peter knows the flesh of God, but he not. Know the mind of God. Let's go to. Am I really done? I'm done. Let's go to Psalms 139. Psalms 139:17 says, how precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them.
Bishop, play something. Let's wrap this up. It took me like 3 days to get to me. So. Glimpses of my own legacy, glimpses. And I can see that at times I've lived underneath the potential. At times I've just put him on the back burner. At times I didn't want to know what he was thinking. At times I didn't talk to him. At times I didn't read about him. I didn't study about him. But man, was I faithful through the Broncos playoffs. And they let me down in the Super Bowl. And yet I wasn't even that faithful to God. And I wouldn't concentrate that much on God. And he says, you know what? It's because you're just like Peter. You're just like Peter. You want to tell me, God, I'll be there in the bad times. And God, I'll be there no matter what. And God, I'll love you all the time. And God, I'll follow you. And then when as soon as the storm hits, it's like, I don't know him. I don't know him. But David says, how precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them. What God is thinking matters to me. Right now, right here, today, what God is thinking matters to me. He loves me more than anybody could love me. He feels me more than anybody could feel me. He lifts me up higher than anybody could lift me.
And yet maybe I haven't put him on my mind as much as he has put me on his mind. And today, church, I ask you to find out what God is thinking. So I give you a word, right? Thus saith the Lord, for ye in the spirit of the Lord, for the Lord tells me to tell you, for God told me to tell you, God is telling me to tell you, God has given me a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, a word of future, a word of healing, a word of life. God has given me that word. But that's the flesh, church. That's the flesh talking to the flesh. I'm asking you to get into the mind of God. To get inside of his mind. I had a dream a while back that the world, that the earth, that the United States, that this city was drowned by a tidal wave. And I had my family all together, and I knew the tidal wave was going to take my vehicle, so we got out of the vehicle, and we all were lined up against this fence. And I grabbed all my family and I said, okay, here it comes. The tidal wave is coming. Let's hang on to the fence. And I hung on to my family and I hung on to the fence. And I remember in the dream the water coming over us and opening my eyes underwater and seeing the look on my family's face. See? Underwater. But if you know what God is thinking, and you know what God is doing at the moments that you begin to go underwater, or the moments that you begin to fight with your emotions, or you begin to fight with your problems, and you say, you know what, though? I know what God is thinking. I'm going to make it. I'm going to survive it. I'm going to overcome it. I'm going to get through it. And even if I don't, there is a crown waiting for me in heaven. There is a gate for me to cross. There is a street for me to walk. There is a mansion for me to live in. That even if I don't make it through what God is putting me through, can you say amen? Because I know what God is thinking. Because I know the precious thoughts of our Savior. Have you ever knelt down, I'm gonna end with this. Have you ever knelt down and said, Lord, I don't know what you're doing. Lord, I don't know what you're doing. That is not the will of God. God said, when you were a servant and I was the master, I hid things from you because you were just a slave. But now that you are my brother, now that we are joint heirs to the kingdom, I hide nothing from you. So it's God's will that we wouldn't say, Lord, I don't know what you're doing. But it is God's will for us to be in a position where we say, I know that God is working on me. I know that God is going to get me through this because I know that God knows exactly what he's doing. And it takes some rain to make the flower grow. It takes some cold weather to make me appreciate the sun. It takes some problems to help me understand the answer. It takes a struggle to help me understand the victory. So God knows exactly what I know what he is thinking. I know what he is thinking. Can you say amen? Amen. I know what he's thinking. I know what he's thinking. No, I'm just going to stop there. Because he says, this is your reasonable service. Someone close to me says, pray that I get this apartment. I pray that I didn't get the apartment. Something in my spirit said, I got something better in store for them than that. And if I let you go too early, it'll be worse. So I'm going to make you wait. What happens when you wait? they that wait upon the Lord